Hey, we are still at the MVP Summit, and I'm joined by Paige Bailey, a co-worker of mine, one of the cloud developer advocates focused on AI and machine learning.
Howdy, y'all.
And also Terry McCann, who's one of the MVPs focused a little bit more on data science and things like that.
Yeah, pretty much, exactly.
We kind of met up because we were having a conversation on Twitter about DevOps for machine learning. And data science.
Yes, right? Which is so exciting and not talked about enough, right?
I completely agree. It's one of these things that if you manage to get it right and you do it, then it's incredible. But it's really hard. It's not something that's super easy to do.
Yeah.
So you don't get that many people really doing it. If you search on Twitter, you pretty much only get Paige's responses come back.
Which is great.
Yeah.
But
also,
and also usually snarky and on Twitter.
Yeah, that's right. So the thing with data science is a lot of the time people are just doing this kind of ad hoc, right? They're not really putting process into actually delivering this.
Well, that's because data scientists aren't really software engineers, right? Like, if you're expecting a data scientist to do software best practices, you're going to have a bad time.
Terry, you were talking to me before about how you're doing work with customers to kind of do what we like to do in DevOps, which is especially with software development, get the software developers to be developing software as their day-to-day rather than thinking about all those other things.
Yeah, and I think it really comes down to at the time that, you know, people really started talking about data science and at the time that DJ Patil came out with his DevOps is the sexiest job of the 21st century, you just saw so many companies just plow straight into spinning up data science teams, probably not thinking massively about what they were doing. And now it's getting to that point where they've had established teams for a few years and they're trying to work out, you know, where's the return on investment? And, you know, I guess the problem really comes from where you have your data scientists are your super smart guys, your PhDs, they have great backgrounds in actually how to build out models, but they're just not necessarily that skilled in traditional software development.
Absolutely, and it's really heartbreaking in that so much of data science and building out predictive models is doing data refreshes. So you have to have that agile development cycle. It can't just be like a waterfall project.
Right, so once you put these models out there and they're starting to work and so on, you still need to, like, it's an evolving thing, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's it. You know, you always have this sort of like, even once you get a model deployed, it's then how do you ensure that that model is still accurate? Because at the point that you really train your model, and at that point, you know, hopefully it is accurate and it's reflective of reality, and then the next day, is it still reflective of reality? It depends on how much your business has changed, how much, you know, your problem domain has changed. It could mean that no longer reflects reality anymore.
How do you test this? Like,
so you have to keep checking back to make sure that the predictions that you're making and your confidence levels make sense. So if your accuracy as dictated by your business requirements is we need to be 85% accurate or higher, if your threshold for that accuracy or your F statistic or whatever thing you care about drops below that threshold, you have to start thinking about data refreshing or model refreshing or completely like retuning hyperparameters or selecting a different algorithm.
Okay, so I'm going to be honest and tell you that I don't really know a great deal about machine learning or data science.
Cool.
Okay.
I'm one of these guys who's like, big data is if it doesn't fit in my RAM, right?
Well, that's a great definition. I don't know a whole bunch about DevOps, to be honest.
And I think this is part of the problem as well. Like, my domain is all around software development, and your domain doesn't have a lot of software developers. And you guys might be a little bit of the exception here.
Yeah, potentially. I mean, you know, when you start breaking, I guess, down DevOps into its core like principles of even just the basic things like source controlling your code, and you look at how many data scientists, you know, actually source control their code. Not many. And that's not necessarily because they're all doing a bad job, but also because source controlling some of the tools that they work with just isn't that easy.
Right.
So you take something like a notebook, like Jupyter Notebooks. It's not the easiest thing to source control that. It's quite, you know, it's quite tricky to actually do that. And yeah, there are some tools coming out that will, you know, hopefully make that easier, but that stuff is quite difficult if that's your way of working.
Yeah, so I usually, I love Jupyter Notebooks. I'm so happy that you mentioned them. And all of the development that I do is on GitHub. But I remember at my previous work, there were kind of silos that data scientists were operating in. And so many data scientist teams are really just one person, right?
Oh, yeah.
And if you have one person, it's you know, it's hard to sell, you know, using Subversion or Git or something of that nature.
Yeah.
So the purpose of the show, what I try to do in this show is give, like, here is exactly how we start solving this problem. And with data science, it's going to be how do
Fun.
We start solving the problem, right? Because
yeah.
it's not like, oh, you use these tools which have been around for decades.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What do you think is the starting point? You mentioned source control. Is that kind of where we should start?
I think definitely. So I think, you know, if you're a data scientist and you already have code somewhere, if that's just on your laptop, then certainly get that into source control.
Mm-hmm.
And then beyond that, I think what I try to do with my customers is work out, well, what's the best way to actually get their model into production? And what's the best way you can get that into production fast enough?
Okay.
And if you look at what languages data scientists, you know, really work with, you get the common ones, Python, R, but it's not just limited to Python and R. There are just, you know, so many other languages. And it's trying to come up with a process that is almost language agnostic. Mm-hmm. That means that data scientist can just focus on what they're really good at. And they focus on the machine learning, the cleansing of that data, shaping it and getting it working. And then the deployment process, hopefully, would just be, regardless of language, I can just deploy that.
Right. Are there tools that you can use for that kind of thing?
So I was thinking about this quite a bit when I was preparing my talk for the MVP summit. So obviously the source control thing is paramount.
Mm-hmm.
Being able to establish checks to do the confidence level checking,
mm-hmm.
the accuracy checking, those sorts of things. And VSTS, from what I've heard of it, it sounds like it could be a great solution.
Yeah.
So placing those kind of checks to make sure that all of your data engineering processes have been documented, checking to make sure that those thresholds don't fall below what they should be, making sure that there's been sign-off from all of the different parties.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds like a good solution. I don't
it's
know.
Like it's an orchestration thing.
Absolutely.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So one of the... So I'm just wrapping up a very similar project. So one of the things that we did is take everything from in VSTS.
Mm-hmm.
So allow the guys to just write code. For our example, it was Python. So just write Python, and then build out all of the infrastructure around that. Automatically. So they focus on writing their Python models. They submit that to source control, which then gets picked up by VSTS, wrapped up into a Docker image. That Docker image should then be deployed to the Docker container registry,
right.
Which then gets picked up and deployed into Kubernetes. So then they just get back the REST API of what they need to call to get the response for their model.
Yeah.
Right.
And so most data scientists, whenever you say, all right, you need to define a schema.json for inputs and outputs, and you need to kind of specialize in a init.py and a run.py and package up your model in that way and put it in a Docker container,
yeah.
They look at you like you're speaking pretty much. So most data scientists, whenever they complete an assignment, it's either a static report or it's like, here you go, here's a CSV file of predictions.
Oh, nice.
And you're like, how do I operationalize this? I want to put this in an app. Like, how do I do that?
Yeah.
And it's incredible how quickly you can go from giving the business something like that to them then saying, okay, great, you know, I want this in my website. I want this as people come in.
Yeah.
I want to change the way that people interact with our website based on the outcome of this.
And I want it to scale.
Yeah,
that's a whole thing as well.
Yeah.
So as well as the monitoring of, does this model actually continue to do what I want it to do?
Yeah.
You know, is it scaling up? Is it mm-hmm. is it accessible from my other software? Is it actually usable in the right way?
Yeah. And are you scaling it just for inferencing, or are you scaling it for the training part as well?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think one of the benefits of having your models deployed in something like Kubernetes is just, you know, that you have that almost infinite scaling. as you know, as somebody starts using your model and you know, you may get a few hits on it and that sort of works, but then when you start getting a few thousand, a few hundred thousand, then we can just scale that out. And so looking at that as something, you know, in Azure with the container instance, the managed one that's in public preview, then that just works perfectly for what we were trying to do.
Yep. And so to get this to work, we kind of need to get data scientists and developers and IT pros in the same room. Mm-hmm. So we're kind of expanding this DevOps to be, what's data science DevOps?
Yeah, we
need to coin some words.
So somebody has coined the Data Ops Consortium. Like the Agile Manifesto. There is now a Data Ops Manifesto, which pretty much is very similar to the Agile Manifesto.
I'm definitely going to put that in the show notes down the bottom as well. So we'll do that. And somebody mentioned as well, you were talking about VSTS as a solution as well. Mm-hmm. I just got emailed something from my boss, Donovan Brown. Mm-hmm. He got forwarded here's a walkthrough of actually doing this kind of stuff with VSTS. But the one thing I noticed is there's a lot of just bash scripts to do stuff.
Yeah.
And that's not something that data scientists are going to be able to put together. So making the tooling a little bit better is definitely something I think we need to focus on.
And also kind of coaching data scientists if they aren't following SDLC best practices.
Right.
So like writing tests, you should be writing those if you're a data scientist. So checking to make sure that your types are consistent with what you would be expecting and that your values are consistent.
And I think testing's a really interesting one as well, because you've got almost two sides of testing. Mm-hmm. You've got the testing that, you know, does my code actually work? Is it doing what I want it to do? So that whole unit tests. But then you've got the testing of, does my model actually produce me an accurate score? And you know, actually storing those, like your accuracy, your F scores, your rock coast area under the curve, all that sort of stuff that then just, again, is so different to traditional software development.
Mm-hmm.
It is definitely tricky, but doable.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So if you are in an organization, if somebody's watching this and they're in an organization where they do a lot of data science, they have data scientists in their own silo that they never speak to as developers, what would you recommend? Like, Terry, how do you actually get this stuff up and running and get these people in the same room and that kind of thing?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think historically it's been difficult because what you generally have is, so a data scientist will build out their models in R, and then they'll go to the operational team and say, hey, I've got this amazing model and I want you guys to deploy it. And then they take a look at it and they're like, no, I'm not gonna deploy that in R. All of our production stuff's in Java.
Right.
So I'm gonna now have to rewrite what you've done in Java, which typically will end up being a completely different model to what the data scientist tried to produce. Accuracy be different, the way it works will be different, probably the input data will be different.
Right.
And I mean, that just can't work.
Yeah, these are kind of familiar problems for people who work in DevOps, specifically with software as well. Mm-hmm. The operations team are often the ones who are saying, well, our systems are not set up to support this .NET framework or this, you know, this profile that you've got here. But if there was a conversation early on, then that problem can be solved jointly.
Yeah, and I think trying to do anything to make it so that your data scientists can do what they do in their language of choice.
Yes.
So by deploying models to a Docker container, then you know, just means that it's isolated from the rest of the business. If that container goes crazy and that stuff isn't very good, then you kill the container.
Yep.
You don't have to worry about all of that stuff. If some brand new language, I mean, you look at somebody publishes a white paper and then 2 weeks later, you've got your data science team saying, you know, oh, I want to do this. I want to start implementing this new language.
Yeah.
It's not necessarily that well tested, that well robust. But again, isolating everything in a Docker container just hopefully should mean that the almost like the area for impact is you know, significantly reduced.
Yeah, definitely. What do you think?
And absolutely. And I think in terms of strategies for interacting with software teams, making sure that the requirements are listed up front.
Yeah, I think we should just
And also that each side respects the other's work, right? Yeah. Because both DevOps and data scientists have incredible challenges, and it's it's awful to work with both of us.
Yeah.
But kind of understanding and getting on the same page in terms of language and what each other would be expecting is so huge.
Yeah.
And frameworks. I'm so glad that you mentioned, you know, and a white paper comes out and people want to try things. It's like everybody has their favorite framework. We're worse than JavaScript.
So. That's a big. Yeah.
I know, man, but it's how it goes.
Awesome. So, yeah. Well, look, so much. Thanks so much for joining me. Let's walk back.
Yeah, must
thanks so much for joining me. This is kind of an aspect of both of these specialties that doesn't really get mentioned very often.
Yeah, definitely not. Mm-hmm.
But I think there's definitely some overlap that these two areas can help each other get things done.
Yeah, and I think it's a really interesting time. Like people are, I say in the last 6 months, more and more people are talking about this.
Yep.
More and more people are realizing that it's a problem. And yeah, hopefully the tools will start coming out that will make it a lot easier for somebody to deploy into production.
Yeah.
And to make sure that it's stayed deployed and kept refreshed.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Uh-huh. All right. Well, thanks so much, guys, for joining me, Paige and Terry. That's all for this episode of DevOps Lab. Stay tuned. There'll be plenty more episodes coming up. Thank you.
Cool.
Awesome.
Thanks.